All right, here we go, lesson three. This one's going to be a long one because there's lots of information in it.
An interval is the measure of distance between two pitches. Intervals are measured using ordinal numbers, such as second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. The eighth is usually referred to as an octave, and the unison is called a prime. The process for naming intervals is all you have to do is count each of the given letters plus each letter in between. As an example, to identify an interval of C to F in the key of C major, what we do is we start on C, we count D and E and F. Thus, the interval is a fourth. As another example, we can count C to A in the key C major. We got C, D, E, F, G, A. Thus, the interval is a sixth. Here we can see the quality of the intervals in the major key signature. They're perfect unison, major second, major third, perfect fourth, perfect fifth, major sixth, major seventh, perfect octave. As you'll recall, all the perfect intervals are unisons, fourths, fifths, and octaves. In order to alter them, we can make them larger or smaller by a half step. To make them larger is called augmenting them and is symbolized by a plus sign. You can see that all I've done is taken the top note, which is the G, and moved it up a half step by making a G sharp, and that would sound like this. The next example I have here is the augmented octave, which is an octave plus a half step, so C to C sharp, as you can see here, and that would sound like this. Next up, we can alter an interval by lowering the top note a half step, which is called diminishing. And that's symbolized by a dim before the number or a degree sign after the number. A diminished interval would look like this in the key of D major. You can see we start on D, and a fourth above the D would be G. And to make it diminished, we need to make it a G flat. And that would sound like this. And then the fifth would be a D to A. And to make it a diminished fifth, we need to make the A an A flat. And that would sound like this. And finally, the octave, which I don't have up here, but if we start on D, an octave above D would be D. And then to make it diminished, we go down to D flat. Next, we have to talk about interval inversion. An easy example would be a fifth to a fourth. An F to a C is a fifth, but a C to an F would be a fourth. The table below demonstrates all of the interval inversions. A unison would invert to an octave, a second to a seventh, a third to a sixth, a fourth to a fifth, and vice versa. A sixth to a third, a seventh to a second, and an octave to a unison. And just so you can get a feel for all those, I'll play them for you now. Here's a unison followed by an octave, a second followed by a seventh, a third, and then a sixth, a fourth and a fifth, a sixth and a third, a seventh and a second, and an octave in a unison. Now, I don't have this up here, but a diminished interval always inverts to an augmented interval, and vice versa. Say you have a diminished third, and that would invert to an augmented sixth, and so on for all the intervals.
Finally, we need to talk about compound intervals. The definition of a compound interval is an interval that is larger than an octave. So, say you want to go from C to the D, an octave above that C. That would be a ninth. To get a compound interval, all you have to do is add 7 to the number of the normal interval. Say you have a second, a C to a D, and you want a ninth. That's the D, an octave above that C. All you have to do is add 7 to the number. Now I'll play some compound intervals for you. This is a ninth, a C to the D, an octave above that C. Here's a tenth, a C to an E, an octave above. Here's an eleventh, a C to the F, an octave above. And finally a twelfth, a C to a G, an octave above.